Hello, I'm Joy Macknight, editor of The Banker. And with me in the studio is Ruth Wandhöfer, an expert in banking and payments, author of several industry books, an advisor, and also a keynote speaker. Thanks so much for joining me, Ruth.
Pleasure, Joy.
So let's talk a little bit about the topics that you cover within the new book that you've just put out, which is called Redecentralisation. But first, let's talk about sort of how different technologies, emerging technologies have really come to play and is really changing, fundamentally changing the financial services industry.
So technology has the power of actually changing business models at the core, which is the most exciting part. Throughout the, last few decades, we've seen very relevant basic AI solutions changing the way businesses deal with data, automate data. We have seen now, of course, increasingly the hype around blockchain for the last 10 years, around maybe doing a slightly better ledger and connecting people in a more transparent way. But there are lots of other elements, such as the API infrastructure we know from UK open banking and in other applications, that has really changed the data flows between businesses, including banks and also non-bank providers more broadly. We also have seen a massive trend of outsourcing. So banks maybe 10 years ago would of course use technologies to empower themselves and deliver solutions, but more and more technology has come to the fore and more outsourcing as a consequence, which also of course bears risk because you need to deal with all your different suppliers. And then we have seen in banking in particular the phenomenon of technology banks. So sort of neobanks that really run on a very agile, regularly changing technology in back office, which is quite different to traditional banking with big tech stacks that need a little bit revamping these days, and how these banks operate differently, very technology driven, sometimes with the consequence that if a technology minded founder of a bank was sort of running the business, they may not have looked at all the relevant pieces for banking per se. So also the culture of banking with compliance, conduct, duty of care to their customers can sometimes have sort of suffered a little bit if you have a completely technology-driven approach. But overall, technology had made massive differences in the financial services industry for automation, speed, and also the rollout of new solutions.
And then how has this move to digitalization of financial services really impacted the end user?
On the positive side, of course, there's more choice for the end user. You can now choose with different types of banking suppliers or e-money institutions, payment institutions. There's a lot more choice in the market, which inevitably brings sometimes confusion for the consumer. And equally, because of the digitization where most of what we do today is done on our little mobile phone and our supercomputer in our back pocket, it has also led to a bit of a divide between older generations of people that are not so apt with technology, because these days, I mean, some platforms you can really only digitally access. There's no branch and there's no support center. So it has created a leap forward, but it has left some people behind. And of course, if you are in a digital financial economy, it creates a real problem if you don't have access to broadband or you don't have access to the actual tools because you either can't afford them or you have an educative gap or you're really just concerned that these bear more risks on your data. And I think the data piece is a really critical cultural one because we're encouraging, I mean, people are sharing more and more data in the younger generations with social media, but this is very, very risky because your identity can be compromised. And then you have other parts of society that are extremely wary of sharing data. And so we need a way of smart data and consent control-based logics, which give back the individual the power to actually be in ownership of their data and decide when to share it under which conditions.
And your book is provocatively called Redecentralization. So what do you mean by that? What is the concept behind that?
So the motivation came really from looking at the past and into the future at the same time. We used to be very decentralized if we think about money. So we're discussing the history of money up from beads to bits, to speak. And in the very past, we were very decentralized, which of course wasn't terribly efficient. But over the decades and over the millennia, we became more and more centralized. Government control, rule of law, technology platforms, very decentralized these days. And of course, money itself has also become decentralized. And the question is, with the decentralization attempts of the cryptocurrency environments, which have largely not necessarily succeeded in replicating money itself, and now the more recent trends around central bank digital currencies, which are again centralized, is there not something in the whole concept of re-decentralization where we need to bring back a balance between the public sector, the private sector, and the actual people? We have seen too much power concentration, very much reflected in technology platforms, in large corporations, where the value is where the data is, which has led to almost giving up personal agency. I see too many people staring into their mobile phones, being almost driven by the algorithms, the allocracy, so to speak, of what these algorithms tell you to do. We need personal agency back, and we need a very robust solution in the digital identity context for Web 3.0 to really work, because you want to be able to access digital services without compromising your data and your identity.
And my last question is really about sort of the conclusion of your book, which is really around developing a new social contract. What do you mean by that?
Classically, a social contract was always between a government and its people. The government would protect the people, and the people would, you know, behave according to the rule of law, which has been established for centuries now. But what we do see very clearly in the last few decades is that the control of governments has been waning. And the control really is with large corporations, particularly now increasingly in the technology space. So I call these the digital states, so to speak. But the digital states tend to have care of duty for their shareholders, not for the individuals that populate the globe, and not necessarily for the environment, which is another can of worms around the whole ESG agenda. So the question, therefore, is, you know, having failed with the social contract in our time, don't we need to think about a new digital social contract? And that translates into a number of key principles that will have to be embedded in the way we design systems, so that we design them with user control in mind, with protection, with data security, as well as in a way that we allow people access. So we need to rethink a number of concepts, but there is a place for technology and financial services to try it out, to have elements of a new digital social contract, which inevitably is borderless and it's global. This is about protecting us in our digital economy at a global level, and these principles would hold for that.
Excellent. So interesting. Thank you so much, Ruth.
Thank you, Joy. Pleasure.